To begin with, a very warm welcome again. I think this is one of the few sessions in which I'm seeing again a full house post-lunch, because usually people either start to move away or get engaged outside. So thank you so much that we are almost starting in time. We have a very diverse panel this time. We have representatives of global multilateral groups. We have a business stakeholder. We have a municipal commissionerate representatives. We have a mayor, and we have an advisor to the government. So pardon us if, and everybody is very passionate about the work that they are engaged in. So we might have a more passionate discussion and question and answer. We are ready for it, because at the end of the day, the entire conference and this panel is about learnings, to share what we have already done and to have takeaways from this panel to see what we can do moving ahead, especially in a collaborative way. To give a context to the entire thing, I just wanted to have a brief, because everybody was asking, governance challenges is very a big, diverse area. So what are we focusing on? And what I wanted to say that the UN Global Compact Network India, which is essentially a business stakeholder group, has been engaging in smart cities essentially because we see potential in the cities to attract finance, to develop. And the best development, as we see from earlier cases, is when there is appropriate governance mechanisms in place. So that is the context where we have come in. And can I just request the slides to come up? So just in a brief, the United Nations Global Compact, an introduction was already given by Dr. Awdhesh, so I'll skip that. And the fact that the Global Compact Network India was established in 2003. According to the mandate given by the UN Secretary General to the Global Compact, he sees that the businesses within the Global Compact are the ones that will provide innovation, will provide strategies for the SDGs to get implemented, which is very important. And within the Global Compact, recently in 2015, when the SDGs came into the picture, when the smart cities were announced, is when the Center of Excellence for Governance, Ethics and Transparency was established. Within the Center of Excellence, we have been working on the key SDG 11, which is sustainable cities, on four essential areas. We have developed an extensive framework for governance of smart cities. The book is there in all your folders. It essentially talks about 10 pillars. How do you go about it? What should be the timeline? How will it benefit? What are the challenges and way forward? So that's something very interesting that could be actually implemented, is what we think. It has come after a long process. It's not academic research kind of a thing that we had worked on. We did stakeholder sessions in the first round of cities that were announced. So Pune, Bhubaneswar, Ranchi, Lucknow and Vishakhapatnam. We realized what could be the issues in the cities. We came up with the initial study. Then we had an MOU with Pune Smart City Development Corporation Limited, PSCDCL. It's a 5-year MOU in which we have been providing governance advisory. And while we have been advising them over the last 1.5 years, we have seen the actual ground level challenges that occur in cities and what could be the avenues that could help. So the 10 pillars of the governance is there. And this is essentially more or less what we are focusing on in this panel discussion. In the cities that we are represented, which are the cities, how is the work happening? Even though the slide and the write-up is too small, it is more about getting things done. So not only questions, so it's not that we definitely come up with questions, but answers, and especially answers on how to go forward. We are also working on PPPs, because nobody has enough money to develop any city by themselves. So a lot of public-private partnership is essential. I think if I'm not wrong, that at least 98-99% of the projects will happen through PPP. And for that, we need a clear, detailed roadmap. So we are coming up with a handbook. It's almost ready of a PPP roadmap with extensive information. So we have accounting framework also for the concessioners and grantors, as well as an exit strategy. Because we have seen other than that, without an exit, PPP models fail. The phases we have outlined, what needs to be done, those kind of things. And then this is the entire project identification. How do we move forward? What do we do? Those kind of things. And the risk assessment framework, because any new development, any new initiative is fraught with risk, both for businesses when they invest and for government agencies when they get partners on board. So what are the risks that have been identified? Essentially, at the moment, we have looked at these particular sectors in any city, and the risk assessment talks about market entry risk, operational, financial, strategic, and how to mitigate this risk. So this toolkit will also be available for development. So essentially, coming back, the major discussion today in today's panel will be on the framework of governance. Governance is a very pet subject. So what do we do and how do we go from there? And what I'll do is, instead of standing at the podium, we don't have presentations, it's a conversation. So I'll take my seat and then we can start with the question answer round. Thank you. Sorry. And that is a very important reminder that Charru has just given, that we are not only talking about smart cities, but smart villages also. And for us, essentially, more than smart cities, it's also been about, because smart cities, we personally believe, has been a good brand in which things have been happened in a timely manner. But there are many cities, many areas that need to develop and are developing, and how can we have a collaborative development in taking things forward. So with that, I'll not take too much time. We'll just go around the panel. And I've requested the panelists to share a brief introduction of themselves. In the introduction, essentially, who do you represent and what do you see perhaps a challenge or an initiative that has overcome the challenge in urban development is what we're looking at. So I'll just start with Charru, please.
Thank you, Shabnam. I'll bell the cat. I'm Charru Malhotra, and I represent Indian Institute of Public Administration as its faculty, specifically in the area of e-governance and ICT. Despite the technology, which is the word technology, which is like kind of sprinkled in my designation and my profile, I would still say I would like to basically talk about the people's perspective and the village perspective. I don't want to give much introduction except that I've been to several villages of our country, when I say several, running across almost 600 to 1,000, stayed with them from 2004 to 10 to understand what makes technology work for them and what would be the conceptual framework to increase the uptake of technologies by people staying in rural areas, rural, urban, block, ward, etc. 27 years of experience, worked with World Bank, ADB, and other UN bodies, almost there with academic institutes as a researcher and their visiting faculty, at least the ones which are in India. Been invited by various countries for the work which I do, which is called as consultation round for citizens. In Hindi, I call it as Nagrik Paramarsh Daur. How do you elicit information out of people living in a country which are so diverse? That's my background. Thank you.
Then I continue. Hello. My name is Sabine Zindera and I'm with Siemens. I traveled all the way from Munich in Germany to come here, and I'm very happy to be here in India again, I must say. First time I had been in India was back in 1992, when Siemens ran a joint venture with Bharti for the production of telephones. Many of you may know that. And today I'm in the legal and compliance department, and my job is to drive what we call collective action, that is building alliances against corruption worldwide. And I'm also the head of the Siemens Integrity Initiative, which is based on the settlements we achieved with the World Bank and the European Investment Bank after the major corruption scandal that we had 10 years ago. So the Integrity Initiative is, so to speak, supported with $120 million. And also here in India, we have three projects. One is with Shabnam and the UN Global Compact. Another one is with the Confederation of Indian Industries. And the third one is with United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime. Of course, cities is a very important topic also for us at Siemens. And the complexity is that big that it cannot be solved by one party alone. So we all need to join forces in order to get things done, to provide water for all, safety for all, great infrastructure for all. And I understand that here in India, the Smart Cities Project is supported by some $15 billion. And yeah, every time when big money is involved, it is certainly wise to follow that money and to look where it goes. And things can be so easy in a way that, you know, good governance should be the basis of everything. And many years ago when I started in compliance, an Indian gentleman told me, he said, "Sabine, things are so easy. Honesty is the best protection." And I strongly believe in that statement, because if you're honest, things are always easy, because you have only one storyline and you can stick to the facts and the rules. Because if you don't do so, things will come to light one fine day. That is my strong belief. It takes a while, but all the criminal stuff will come to light. So good governance can be very easy, but it needs to be done. And of course, procurement guidelines need to be updated. We are big fans of e-government, because e-government is always based on solid processes. And for us in the private sector, why do we do it and why are we passionate about it? It is because we can mitigate the risk of doing business. And we as, let's say, business people and investors always look for great business climate and a safe environment to do our clean business. I would like to congratulate Shabnam. Shabnam, you and your project is really outstanding. And we just recently had, upon request of the World Bank, a midterm review on all the projects that we have done in the field of anti-corruption, and your project was rated as one of the very best. So congratulations for that. And there is also good news that I would like to share. In mid of March, we will be launching our third funding round. We will do that in a very public process. We will be looking for another 20 or 25 new projects worldwide. I hope that India will deliver submissions for that, and we will be spending another $30 million on that. Well, that is the brief introduction and my passion and petitum for good governance.
Thank you so much, Sabine and Charru. I just thought that maybe while we're talking about the global projects, Michael, would you like to go now and then we can come back to our cities so that we are all in, there's a mic. So, introduction, what do you represent and what do you want to?
Yes, certainly. Thanks, Shabnam. I'm the director of the UN Global Compact Cities Program, and so it's not about compact cities, but it's about how the cities program can help form collaborative partnerships between civil society, government, and the private sector, but particularly brokering private sector into high impact projects that can both support the sustainable development goals, the principles of the global compact, but also how to build capacity and accelerate to form the projects that mean the most at a local level, but to be able to do that at scale along with our partners. So in an overall capture, we're just about to launch our city partnerships program in India as of today. So this is a significant program supported by Real Dania out of Denmark, a large philanthropic organisation which supports the C40 initiative globally and is now supporting this initiative. But it's the collaboration between the local businesses forming together with the local, or the, say, in this instance, the Indian network of the Global Compact, along with a range of both responsible investment partners and finance organisations, as well as universities locally in each of the countries that we'll be doing this to help build capacity, provide business case or business students to support business cases, and of course research, so that what we do is useful for organisations all around the world. But I'll leave it there as an introduction. Thanks, Shabnam.
So that was just to give a global perspective, because since morning we have been talking about development, the larger picture. India, with its smart cities, is definitely up ahead in the game. But at a recent meeting in which Michael and myself were together, in which 185 countries were there of the world, everybody has been talking about smart cities, everybody has been talking about innovation, what's happening. But most of all, the implementers from a different establishment have also been talking about essential challenges as to how they would, like, they have big dreams, but how do you get them fulfilled? And that is something which we'll go to the next stakeholder group within the panel. And may I request any of the speakers, if they want to start first? Theek. So Agarwal sahab, so may I request the youngest, Gaurav, just to talk about your city, your dreams and the challenges, please.
Sure. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. A post-lunch session, I'll keep it very light. My name is Gaurav Mishra. I am the Chief Operating Officer for Raipur Smart City Limited. So basically, I'm pretty sure all of you are aware that, you know, the entire smart city plan was the start of this entire smart city plan was based on citizen engagement. And when in Raipur we were preparing the SCP, the smart city plan, we surveyed 141,000 citizens, and that's how we came up with the projects that we have lined up. So the major three requirements there were the traffic, of course, the waste management, and the third was environment. I'm also sure that most of the cities in India would have these as the primary requirements to be taken care of by the ULBs. Now, when you talk about the word collaboration, someone before lunch, sir from Pune, he highlighted some very important issues regarding the governance and the empowerment of the SPVs. I was with IIM Ahmedabad for a very short while, and there we discussed a few of the government's issues in the SPVs right now. There were 31 commissioners from various cities, and one question, you know, the one common thread that each one has in their questions was empowerment of the SPVs. So when we talk about the empowerment right now, the SPVs are, you know, also considered a part of the municipal corporations in most of the cities, and which is in a way very good, because most of the projects that we wish to do, we wish to execute, they require help from the police department, the municipal corporation, the PWDs and all. But in the overall process, you know, the SPV, the entire motto behind creating these SPVs was to empower them to make the decision faster and to implement and execute the projects in the timeline. In the recent news that we had in the Times of India, only 5 to 6% of the fund has been spent so far of the out of total $15 billion that have been allocated. So what could be the reason in 2 years, 2.5 years from the date of inception, we are still not even, you know, one third of the journey has been completed. So the biggest and one of the most important reasons, because I work, we work at the ground level. I'll not talk about the technology. I'll talk about the micro issues that happen that are to be narrated. So empowerment of SPVs probably is one of the important aspects that we need to look right now. We have not lost much time, and whatever time in the last 2 years, we have done a lot of planning. I think all of us have hired the consultants. We have two consultants with us, and they are doing a great job. We have DPS and all prepared. Now, when it comes to the implementation stage, and all the stakeholders, the political parties, the municipal corporations, other ULBs involved, other agencies have to come on a common platform. And that was the reason why the board of directors was formed for the SPVs. And these board of directors have the secretaries of the states, and people from collectors are there, and people from the police department are there. Now, with this approach, we are now set to launch. We last 2 years, I'm pretty sure my media friends might not be happy with this, but in last 2 years, what we have been doing was we were doing planning. We were doing planning, we were meticulously working on the projects that we are supposed to execute. We, on the ground level, to start a project, tendering is very easy. But before tendering, you have to prepare the DPS. We have to go into minutes of those projects. So survey, it starts from the surveys, then we have feasibility and all those things. So my humble submission today to all the ULB leaders here and to all the distinguished panel members here is to come up with a framework, comprehensive framework, to empower the SPVs and let them work with the speed and with the pace they wish to work. Probably if this happens, we would be able to achieve the target in time. I see by 2025, we'll have a beautiful landscape, a beautiful picture of smart cities across India. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gaurav. It's very important because I think this was the exact point that Vikas or somebody in the earlier panel talked about. When we talked about the knowledge portal, we said that especially the cities that are present here are the cities that have come up in the fourth round. So maybe cities in the first, second, third round, whatever development has happened, because there have been teething problems in all cities. There's been no city across the country that can say that they started with they ended with the same speed that they started. So there have been roadblocks and challenges, how they have ever overcome, and what could the other cities learn from them. So essentially, I think the plans of all the cities are already online, but the empowerment of the SPVs is a very important aspect, I think, which will be the next step that we do from this particular conference onwards. So thank you for pointing that out. Mr. Saran, will you? So both of our panelists are from UP, which has this tendency of going first. Yeah.
Good afternoon. I hope I am being relevant in this session, and I'm going to reflect on some of the issues which I am seeing. While the rush of blood to implement transformational urbanism is being, everybody is trying to do. And I would like to share what changed Ahmedabad from a bankrupt municipal corporation to a corporation which had its first credit rating of AASO, which was investment grade, and floated the first bond. From bankruptcy to this took two years. And the first issue was to professionalize the cadres of municipal of the cities. That is the most important issue. Our cities are today not equipped to face the complex challenge of urbanization. That's the biggest issue. And if we completely depend upon present cadres which are not in tune with the challenges, we are really going to get into a lot of trouble about it. So the first issue, we brought in more than 60 MBAs and chartered accountants into municipal corporation to look at accounts, to completely computerize the systems, to actually track projects and to do everything. That changed. This management services division in the municipal corporation changed the way things happen. The second thing is, we have cities which with zero planning inputs. Absolutely. There is no urban planning in the cities. really speaking. And so much money is being poured into unplanned cities. So it's actually creating a huge issue in terms of that they don't know floor area ratio concepts, there is no land use planning, there is no zoning, and then there is this rush of resources through smart cities into one particular convergent area, which about, I've been hearing the SPV story, it is true. But a lack of planning, we have concentrated in creating ugly, inefficient, and unhealthy cities in our country. Delhi is the biggest example of it. Delhi, after another 10 years, you will not be able to move at all. And you won't be, of course, if you survive this city. So it is, we are living inside a gas chamber here. There is no professionalism to actually deal with it. And from time to time, from crisis to crisis, people respond. There is no systemic strategy. Third issue is, what I am seeing is a scramble for expenditure, a scramble for project, because money is getting poured in under pressure, which the cities are not being able to absorb easily because of the lack of professionalism and capacity. And then there is a scramble. And that scramble is extremely dangerous, because what Sabine just talked about is whether we are going to stick to highest standards of integrity. That won't happen easily. If you have a scramble, there is a need to really sit down and think about quality assurance and construction standards, and to enforce the idea of asset management and service standards in local bodies. There is no life cycle project being developed. Cities are moving ahead without a strategy, without a city development strategy. And we are talking about cities which are supposed to be engines of economic growth. So every city must have at least a 5-year strategy. This is our priority. This is where we are going. So there's this quality assurance issue and the rush. Another thing which I am seeing in the cities is that there is a lack of officers at the second tier who really understand. You have municipal commissioners who are very enthusiastic. We have now in UP, we have mayors who are absolutely dynamic. They can change, transform a city. But below the municipal commissioner, there is a problem at the second tier where, you know, we are struggling with credit rating in one of the cities. Audit is not done. Additional some deputy commissioner that they have been told to go ahead and do it. He can't get it done because below the chief account officer doesn't quite have the confidence to rush it. So that is a big issue which we are seeing. And in the midst of, in Ahmedabad, we had a system of not discussing any day-to-day problem for 3 hours in the morning every day. From 7:30 to 10:30, every day for 3.5 hours, we discussed strategy and priority. We discussed resources. We discussed projects. We discussed collaboration. We had a great collaboration with industry and other things. But we gave a lot of time to issues of importance, not of urgency. Because if you are running a city, if you run a city the way everybody runs a city, you'll be running around from one post to the other the whole day without having any impact. So you got to have a strategy. You got to prioritize and do it. So there is a lot to say. And last issue is resource management. When you go to a city, generally, there is a reluctance to discuss finances. You know, because people feel, oh my God, where are we taking this guy? He's coming from World Bank and all that. He's asking questions. And there is a general reluctance to focus on resources and financial issues. and which is one of the biggest features of lack of professionalism. Can you imagine, in India, we can add 2% to the GDP, if you really look at it. If we can make city management professional, and we make cities act as engines of economic growth, they will stimulate. Just redevelopment can stimulate so many resources. But nobody knows how to do redevelopment. They can do redevelopment, they can do impact fees, they can play around with FAR, they can play around with densities, they can connect it to mobility. But this people don't know how to do it. The first time when we talked about a complete street in Lucknow, the chief engineer of PWD honestly told us that, sir, the concept is remove the footpaths and widen the street, okay? But people don't understand that the wider the street, the greater would be the gridlock. So you've got to have footpaths, you've got to have a complete street. And the chief engineer said, sir, we have never heard of this idea before. The first time you're telling us, what is remarkable, they are wanting to do it. There is a lot of enthusiasm in Uttar Pradesh. I want to convey that. Politically and professionally. We have amazing municipal commissioners and absolutely mayors of great quality. And I think they can make a difference. But we have to, what I would request you, is to see how we can really support in strategy building. That is number one. In building capacities in terms of professionalization. And also, there is this issue of, in Uttar Pradesh, now, you know, we have 10 smart cities. These 10 smart cities will have their own IT standards, each one of them. There is no common standard platform that can be adopted at the state level. We got to do something if there is a procurement issue or there is an issue of SPV not really working out. We got to come out with some serious thinking. SPV issue is going on for the last 1 year. But at least have at the state level some standard systems which you can help us. And lastly, the private sector. We really benefited from the infusion of private sector in Ahmedabad. The CG road which we built at that time, the bond and its institutional placement. CG road was built by Arvind Group, not Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation. We gave them advertising rights. And in the institutional placement of the bond and in creating the impact of positioning and branding of a city, the local Ahmedabad Management Association, Indian Institute of Management, all of these people came together and made sure that the market understood the signal of Ahmedabad that it was a viable city going for the first time for a municipal bond without any sovereign guarantee. So I think for me, throughout my career, I have seen that it is professionalization, professionalization, professionalization. And then we will be able to do all the things that you guys want done. Otherwise, it will stay here in this in these beautiful conference room with chandeliers. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that brilliant understanding. I just wanted to point out that before we started the discussion, sir was thinking what he would speak and what he could get to the table. And it's just the years of experience in actually handling cases that talks about not only the challenges, but also the strategies, the resources and collaboration. And I remember one of my mentors when I'm like in this development field also had the same thing. He said, we have enough discussed enough problems. There's enough writing about it. Let's discuss solutions. So I think with that in mind and the fact that, as sir pointed out, that mayors of cities, especially in Uttar Pradesh and, of course, other states, are the pillars of development and they can really take things forward. I'll just pass over the mic to the mayor from Muradabad. Sir.
Thank you, Ms. Sabine Zindera, Vice President, Legal and Compliance, Chairperson Shabnam Siddiqui, the Director Center of Excellence for Governance, UN Global Compact Network, and Gaurav Mishraji, Shri Keshav Saranji, or Charru Malhotra ji, साथ में सभी डायस पर उपस्थित और सभी इस हॉल में ऑफिशियल्स बुद्धिजीवी वर्ग मेयर्स सभी को मेरा सादर नमन और वंदन बंधुओं स्मार्ट सिटी बनाने के लिए पहले तो मैं भारत सरकार का धन्यवाद करूंगा इसके साथ ही जो वर्ल्ड बैंक के द्वारा इस आयोजन का किया गया है वर्ल्ड बैंक के सभी पदाधिकारियों को भी मैं धन्यवाद दूंगा हिंदी में बोले आराम से खुल के चूंकि सभी यहाँ अधिकारी वर्ग हैं सारे बुद्धिजीवी वर्ग हैं और काम करने वाले लोग हैं हम लोग जनता के द्वारा चुने हुए प्रतिनिधि हैं जनता को हम लोग एक जब जाते हैं चूंकि हम लोगों का चुनाव डायरेक्ट पब्लिक के द्वारा होता है तो हमारे कमिटमेंट होते हैं उन कमिटमेंट को फुलफिल करना टाइमली फुलफिल कराना ये हमारे जो ऑफिशियल्स हैं एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन है उनका काम है अभी केशव जी बोल रहे थे एसपीवी के लिए तो ये स्टेट गवर्नमेंट का और सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट के बीच में है फिर भी ओवरऑल मेयर और जो एमएलए हैं एमपी हैं उन सब का रोल रहेगा और रहता है और हम ही लोगों के उसके ऊपर आगे उस चीज़ को चलना है तो आज का जो विषय है इस समय इस सेशन का वो है स्मार्ट सिटी एंड स्मार्ट विलेजेस गवर्नेंस एंड पॉलिसी रिलेटेड चैलेंजेस तो इससे पहले स्मार्ट सिटी पे काफ़ी सभी लोगों ने काफ़ी डिस्कशन किया है किसी भी शहर की संरचना उसकी संस्कृति के आधार पर होती है भारत की संस्कृति में विलेजेस एक इसका मुख्य पार्ट है क्योंकि मैं विलेजेस के ऊपर बात करूंगा इस समय और विलेजेस के अंदर जो हमें सबसे पहले जो भारत की संस्कृति के हिसाब से मैं विलेज को लेकर चलूंगा क्योंकि इसके अंदर तीन चीज़ें हैं गांव गंगा और गाय मतलब जो हमारे जानवर जो होते हैं चाहे वो गाय है भैंस है अन्य गांव के अंदर ये तीन चीज़ें हैं उन तीन चीज़ों के अंदर गाँव कब बनेगा स्मार्ट भाई हम स्मार्ट सिटी की बात कर रहे हैं 100 स्मार्ट सिटी हमारे बनने जा रहे हैं बड़े बड़े शहर हर प्रदेश के 8-10 शहर को चुना गया है उत्तर प्रदेश के भी हमारे 10 शहरों को चुना गया है सौभाग्य से मुरादाबाद एक एक्सपोर्ट की हैंडीक्राफ्ट की पीतल नगरी के नाम से जाना जाता है और एक ऐसा शहर है जिसकी अपनी एक विरासत है एक संस्कृति है हमें उसको भी संजोना है उसको भी बनाना है कैसे हमारे यहाँ के लोग हमारे यहाँ के दस्तकार हमारे यहाँ के कारीगर हमारे यहाँ के अन्य लोग कैसे उनको हम बेहतर जीवन दे सकें तो मैं पहले गांव की तरफ आता हूँ जिसके अंदर हम लोग बहुत बड़ी बड़ी बातचीत करते हैं और हम उसको इम्प्लीमेंटेशन करने की बात करते हैं मेरा कहना है एक समयबद्धता 3 वर्ष स्मार्ट सिटी को डिक्लेयर हुए हुए हो चुके हैं 3 वर्ष पूरे होने पर अब 100 स्मार्ट शहरों की घोषणा हो पाई है मैं समझता हूं अभी उनमें से 50 शहरों में भी पूरी तरह काम भी स्टार्ट नहीं हो पाया होगा पर आने वाले टाइम में हमें समय बद्धता के हिसाब से क्वालिटी के हिसाब से जन भावनाओं को ध्यान में रखते हुए कार्यों को करना है उसके ऊपर हमें विचार करना होगा। एक प्रैक्टिकल तौर पे अगर हम कोई विदेश में सभी जगह में घुमा हूँ और अपने भारत के भी अंदर सभी शहरों को मेरा देखा हुआ है, 17 वर्षों से लगातार मेयरशिप कर रहे हैं मैं और मेरी वाइफ। अब गाँव के अंदर सबसे पहली चीज है कि किसान जो है उसकी जो खेती है वो खेती को कहाँ रखे। खेती को पैदा तो कर लिया है, पिछले दिनों यहाँ पर आलू की इतनी पैदावार हो गई कि लोगों को सड़कों पे फेंकना पड़ा, तो उसके लिए मैं वर्ल्ड बैंक के अधिकारियों से कहना चाहूँगा कि उसके लिए भंडारण की व्यवस्था करें, मतलब वेयर हाउस, जो सबसे पहली चीज है कि गाँव को उसके किसान को समृद्ध बनाने के लिए भंडारण की व्यवस्था करें, वेयर हाउसेस बनाएं, उस किसान को उसकी फसल का उचित मूल्य मिले, उसके लिए मार्केटिंग होनी चाहिए, वहां पर मतलब बाजार बनना चाहिए, हाट बननी चाहिए गांव में। गांव के अंदर लोगों का पलायन ना हो, उसके लिए वहां पर हम बेहतर वह स्कूल दें, मेडिकल हॉस्पिटल्स बना के दें और लेडीज के लिए बेहतर वहाँ थोड़ा मनोरंजन का साधन हो। हम लोग भारत सरकार के द्वारा स्वच्छ भारत मिशन में ODF शौच मुक्त भारत को बनाने का संकल्प है, पर 21वीं सदी के अंदर 70 वर्ष आज हमारे भारत को आजाद हुए हुए हो गए, फिर भी अभी तक हम अपने देश को शौच मुक्त नहीं कर पाए हैं, इसकी ओर गंभीरता से कार्य होना चाहिए। हम लोग कहते हैं कि ये हमने ODF कर दिए, फला गांव, इतने गांव ODF कर दिए, पर वास्तविक तौर पे जब तक हम लोग मानसिकता नहीं बदलेंगे, लोगों के अंदर अवेयरनेस नहीं लाएंगे, तब तक वो शौच मुक्त नहीं हो सकता। तो इसलिए उसके लिए बेहतर से बेहतर प्रोग्राम बनाने चाहिए। वर्ल्ड बैंक के द्वारा अगर भारत के अंदर 6 लाख गांव हैं तो वो बिल्कुल तय कर लें कि प्रत्येक गांव के अंदर अलग से प्रैक्टिकल तौर पर बनना चाहिए। भारत सरकार पैसा दे रही है, 4000 पहले उसके खाते में जाएगा, फिर 4000 का काम और करेगा, ऐसा नहीं है, वो स्वयं बना के दे दे, वो कह दे कि इस गांव के अंदर 500 घरों के अंदर टॉयलेट्स बनने हैं, तो 500 घरों का टॉयलेट जैसे हम शहरों में बनाते हैं ऐसी वहाँ पे भी बनाने चाहिए, मेरा एक एडवाइस है, सुझाव है।
थैंक यू सर। मैं चाह रही थी कि क्योंकि हमारे पास टाइम बहुत कम है,
मैं 2 मिनट में बात खत्म करता हूँ अपनी। स्कूल, कॉलेज, रोड ट्रांसपोर्ट, कनेक्टिविटी और विलेजेस के अंदर खेत को पानी कैसे मिले, मार्केटिंग, बाजार और गुड गवर्नेंस, जो ग्राम प्रधान है हमारे, जो हमारी वहाँ पे उनके फाइनेंस के पावर है, वो सब चीज़ों पे अगर हम गंभीरता से विचार करेंगे तो निश्चित हम अपने विलेजेस को भी स्मार्ट बनाने में सफल होंगे और शहरों के लिए जो हमारा ये गंगा मिशन और ये अन्य प्रोग्राम चल रहे हैं, जो लोकल बॉडीज़ के ऊपर जल निगम के द्वारा कार्य कराए जा रहे हैं, उसको भी हमारे उसको स्टेट गवर्नमेंट को देखना पड़ेगा कि वो उसको प्रॉपरली काम को कर पा रहे हैं या नहीं कर पा रहे हैं। जय हिंद, जय भारत, वंदे मातरम।
थैंक यू सो मच सर, दैट वाज अ ब्रिलियंट प्रेजेंटेशन। आई जस्ट क्विकली रीकैप इन इंग्लिश फॉर द ऑडियंस दैट डज नॉट अंडरस्टैंड हिंदी, बिकॉज आई थिंक द लैंग्वेज ऑफ द लैंड इन विच यू कैन बी मच मोर पैशनेट अबाउट द चैलेंजेस दैट यू आर फेसिंग। So 4 essential points that I could take out from sir's presentation is that the entire smart city and village campaign has to be time bound delivery, because other than that just the 4 rounds have taken 3 years, so we need to finish and get deliverables on time. He was very keenly passionate about one, teaching marketing to farmers so that there's the entire issue of middle person can be like curtailed, as well as warehouse for villages, so that there is larger life for the produce. And to stop migration, better hospital and educational facilities, so that the youngsters especially do not start migrating elsewhere. And most of all, a complete attitudinal change through awareness that could make it possible that when we are talking about smart cities, the smart villages also develop simultaneously, and the entire country grows together. I think on that note, I'll just request Charru to interject, because Charru has been working a lot with smart villages. So both the challenges and the solution that you can talk about.
Thank you, Shabnam. Thanks all of you for being here, I mean, despite your own commitments. Thanks World Bank and other partners to be able to create this kind of collaborative platform. And I would also like to thank the mayor of Moradabad for not just speaking about what were the concerns, but speaking it from the heart. That is what constitutes the signature style of Indian villages: the passion, the sincerity. So I'll pick the thread from there. Shabnam has given me two tasks. So I'm just being extempore. Check me if I go overboard being a professor. But anyway, so I'll have a two-pronged strategy. A, I'll talk about the issues which he's already elicited. B, I'll come to some kind of framework which I just evolved here, asking these people, all of you, in fact, about the concerns. And because smart village seem to be our core concern at this point of time, I thought I'll try to do my, you know, justify my lunch here. Okay, so first thing, Shabnam asked me to list down all the problems. So the first problem, sirs, all of us have, is the concept of smart cities itself. Sitting in India, some of us 3 or 4 years ago, aided by World Bank, decided to call it as smart republic. I don't think we should be either smart cities or smart villages or smart wards. We should be for the people, by the people, of the people, which is republic, and we should be a smarter republic through technology if possible. Second is the context. Now, as I said, I've been to various villages of the country. One size will not fit all in Indian context of smart villages. Go to Ernakulam, go to Tikamgarh, go to Varanasi, come to Punjab. Each of the villages of our country have a signature style which is not found elsewhere in other parts of the country, especially the developed countries. If I do not retain that signature style while smarting the whole process, I would not have takers for that product. The product would not be sustainable. And last but not the least, it would die a natural death because it's not been maintained by the people for whom it was meant. Then I come to the concept, the plan, which was also brought out by one of our speakers. Yes, we don't plan, but even when we plan, we end up creating paper tigers. While planning for villages, despite being from the tech background myself, that MCA and IIT, please ignore that. Please take in consideration, technology will never work if it does not respond to the local knowledge systems of our country. India is so rich in traditional knowledge systems. If we do not plan keeping in stock whatever is available at the grassroots, whatever we dump on them, it would not work. While planning, let's not forget the lofty goal of SDG. Prior to it, with due regards, I've never been a kind of an advocate of any other kind of goals we've talked about ever. But somehow when it comes to SDGs, they seem to be so holistic in nature. So the end product, if it is SDG, I mean any of the 17 goals, we should not forget that to achieve these goals, we have to take people along with us. Because it is for them that we have to achieve these goals. And to take them along with us is not just participation in terms of asking them to tell us what they need,
But also, as Harsh also pointed out, the bottom-up approach of capturing data from them. To achieve SDG, I have to keep going backwards and keep assessing how much I have achieved with regard to a particular SDG. So where do I get the tangible data from there? To get that tangible data, I have to start getting baseline surveys and getting baseline data from people themselves. And for that, I have to rope in all my kudumshiris, all my self-help groups, my NGOs, etc. When I say my, means India. Then I come to the content. When we come to the content, I've been in industry for 30 years now, as an academic, as a practitioner, as a programmer, system analyst, leader, whatever. I was just trying to draw a timeline of how we have been handling content in technology. We have been handling content in technology way back in 90s from technology perspective. Well, we have mainframes, let's start using them. We have RDBMS, let's start creating our databases. This is technology-centric approach. Somewhere over a period of 1990s and later, we became sector-specific. When we became sector-specific, we started saying, okay, transport should be smart, sanitation should be smart. Now, as a consultant or as a leader or as a policymaker like a mayor here, if I tell them to go sector-specific, a lot of biasness and mangling will come up, a lot of intersections will come up. You would not know where to start from because there's so much to do. So last is what I've been always saying. Way back from 2000, I think Vikas and I were probably few people in the country at that time to talk about citizen centricity from citizen inclusive perspective. That means you can't design for them till you don't take them on board. And for doing that, when I take content from the perspective of citizens, when I started doing my research, it did not work out. Why would it work out? When I go and sit with a group of women, let's say in a drought-struck area in Orchha district, and start asking them, what do you need? They might sit with me because I allure them. They might sit with me because I'm through a proper channel of a tehsildar or a jamidar or whatever. But do you know what happens in the end? At the end of the day, they end up losing that one day narega labor wages to no avail. So you have to find better models of eliciting response from them. And those models, as I said, Nagarik Paramarsh Daur are very good. We also have another issue, which is awareness. Okay, awareness and sensitization is something. I've been to some villages where you have a common service center on the top, but the jamidar there, the landlord there, does not even know it exists there. So when I ask him, how do you get your passport made? He said, ma'am, I go to a particular office, a government office, and I give so much of bribe. Why don't you go upstairs? Well, that is just a computer training center. When I say awareness, I mean awareness to that kind of level, you know. Okay, now coming to the actual C, which, I mean, there are several C's I've talked about: content, concept, context. But there's one C I don't want you to forget about, is the smart itself, that is computer. That's the easiest way to understand technology, sir.
Charu, so when, yeah. We need to...
Are we really over? I can't believe that, okay.
Actually, that's so, what happens when you're speaking, we don't realize the time,
I
all of us.
I thought, okay. So last, I'll just have the last word here, Shabnam, thanks. I can't dare to defy you. Collaborate. Who pays? Why should I be involved? Also, please, let's stop talking of public-private partnerships in villages. Let's talk of what I've been saying. Public-private, panchayat, and people's partnership. Let the village elder be roped in. Let the communities be rolled in. Governance, digital teams, standards, enterprise infrastructure, deliverables, quality. Last but not the least, let governance not lose sight of governance itself. I hope I'm clear. Okay, I don't want my tehsildars to be attending programs in my institute, training programs on e-governance, and completely forget about an old tribal widow sitting there waiting for her scheme to happen. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Really, like, I hate this job of cutting people short because I realize that all of us here in the room are practitioners, we are implementing projects, we are seeing dreams. But the idea is, because not only on the panel, we know a lot of people in the audience, especially the implementers of the project, are facing challenges. So if we can, before we go to the second round in the panel on solutions, even though the script does not talk about solutions, but we would like to end on a positive note. Can we take 4 to 5 challenges? If anything has been repeated till now, we can skip that. But if there's anything new that other city commissioners, mayors, knowledge providers want to flag off at this point, we'll take the challenges before we move to the solutions. Just 4 to 5 at this point. Is there a mic in the audience? Faizan? Introduce yourself. Quick question. We are not expecting anybody to know all the answers. So we'll just take the questions at this point and then move ahead. Question to the... Any takers? If there's no question, that's perfect. But no, there is.
Ma'am, my first question is that, is any provision in smart village like 3 to 4 issues, like smart education? There is very poor level in education in village. Second is health sector. If you make very smart village or cities, then 4 and 5 issues will definitely complete them in within time span. Third one is sewerage system is very poor or there is no management system. Our government says we have made very big number of sochalas, but there is no provision how there is the waste is goes. Even that toilets completely dead the natural groundwater. The next one is water supply system is very poor. There is no body who say or talk about the water supply in village. And next one is connectivity of village to these services. If government is not available or the private institutes are not sure that these facilities not developed in these village, then how can these people reach to them?
Thank you. Agarwal sir? Just before the second question comes, I just wanted to introduce Mr. Devendra Agarwal. He's the Chief Financial Officer of Pune Smart City. What Mr. Keshav Saran was talking about, professionalism, Pune has embarked on that by getting professionals to handle the city now, and I hope it's showing results. Sir.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you, Shabnam. My question is to Mayor, sir, and Raipur CEO, honestly, and for the whole house to contemplate. And my question is restricted only from a smart city perspective. The problems in this country of Republic are pretty large, which smart cities are not meant for addressing in totality. So I'll restrict my question to Mayor sir and CEO. The first question is that smart cities have no taxation power. Is there a business model for a smart city? That is number one. Number two, as Mayor rightly said, in India, we hesitate to talk about finance. Well, any service, any development has to pay for itself. The finance, after all, what does government or anybody does, any development agency does? It finds certain resources, deploys them, give that development to the citizens, and citizens ought to pay. So why, what is the solution that World Bank or this forum or anybody else thinking about the finances of smart cities? Thank you.
We are just taking a couple of questions. Any other question? Ranjan, and then the girl at the back.
Good afternoon, all. My name is Ranjan Mishra. I represent Vision 360 Management Consulting. We are a knowledge partner to United Nations Global Compact in the areas of smart city. Been working with Pune for the last 1.5 years. Well, my question is that, there are a lot of people who are interested to contribute towards the governance areas. There are cities who are looking at such services, but both of them are, operating in silos. How do we connect? Are cities really getting benefited, out of so much of knowledge? We're talking about 130 crore people. I think, we got, one of the fantastic brains in this country. So how the cities actually would get connected? Can we talk about a platform wherein actually they connect with each other? Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Garima. I'm an intern with IIPA and pursuing bachelor's. So my question is, smart cities and behavior change go hand in hand. So how are we incorporating them for a successful smart city plan? Thank you.
One last
Hello, I am Gaurav from TCS. So, I am repeating the things. That is, first thing, digital literacy. If we talk about rural India, that is more than 65% of population resides there. There we have only 6% digital literacy. So how we are targeting this? Second is, if we are talking about green growth project here, that is waste management and pollution control, how we are targeting this? And if we talk about like in Pune, we have a very good waste management system there, and how we are taking as a citizen participation there. We have a very good feedback, online feedback mechanism there. And other thing, do we have any software model? We are talking about here integration of green growth project. So we have a, India is a diverse country. And a different type of villages, different type of cities. So do one thing we need, one is a basic model. And another, do we have basic need, that is electricity. Still 240 million people don't have access to electricity. So first, how we are achieving basic model? That is, if I am talking about any building project, so builder have a proposed plan. Okay, my building look like this 1 year before. Then after 2 year, it look like this. So do we have any plan here, like in Bareilly or any in smart cities? So, and what is the after the basic need? If we complete our basic need, that is electricity or other infrastructure, then how we are going to achieve like advanced technologies, how we are implementation, like Wi-Fi? Because I cannot talk about Wi-Fi or any other technologies if I don't have access to electricity. Thank you.
Thank you, Gaurav. So we'll just pick up the question of the smart villages first. Charru, if you want to go briefly, and then Mayor sir can respond.
Agarwal sahab ko batana chahunga ke smart city ek mission hai. Duniya ke andar Bharat ek aisa desh hai jahan par 100 smart city banne ja rahe hain. Hindustan mein 4054 shaharon mein 100 shaharon ka chayan hua hai. Kisi vyakti ke upar burden nahi padne ja raha hai iska bilkul bhi. केवल उसको सुंदर बनाने के लिए, सही बनाने के लिए, बेहतर सुविधाएं देने के लिए उसके अंदर जो प्रोग्राम लगाए गए हैं, उन्हीं को इम्प्लीमेंटेशन करने की बात की जा रही है. किसी को नया टैक्सेशन या कोई नई चीज बनाने के लिए नहीं, जो शहर बसेगा, बढ़ेगा, उस पे टैक्सेशन लगाएंगे उसकी चीज को, आमदनी को कायम करने के लिए. धन्यवाद.
मेयर साहब, पूना जो है, Pune is very much ahead as far as smart cities, as far as smart cities are concerned. So let us, I think they understand what is, and they are asking the right questions. I am a little concerned that the entire national development issues have come up in this 1.5 hours, to which this conference should be able to respond. May I request that you take five or six themes on which you can decide to work, so that there are some outcomes of this. Otherwise, the entire national problems may not be able to be solved by this conference in 1.5 hours.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks. I'll not take sector-specific concerns which this scientist brought out in terms of education, health, and sanitation. I would just say there are villages in our country which we visited, like there's a village near Bhuj which takes care of smart education. They have totally blackboard-less tablet-driven education system where the content is coming from cloud. How did they fund it? They did crowdsourcing, they did crowdfunding, and they are selling their own traditional knowledge systems to people outside the village as well as outside that. To answer this further, please, I could share with you the Taobao village of China, which is a wonderful model to address the sanitation issues, etc. We've already proposed a framework to DRPG on use of big data and artificial intelligence for sanitation issues. How do you look at those concepts? So I'll just probably take this question after that. My researcher, Rashmi, is also with me. We work together on it a lot. Then we come to the next question, of which I believe was presumably from TCS Gaurav, where he talked about digital literacy. I'll just pick up that. Now let me share with you, Gaurav, being in TCS, you should know about the emerging technologies. There is something called as conversational user interface, where literacy will be inconsequential. The only thing is, probably India in the center needs to work a lot on Unicode and natural language processing to come up with our own series and other versions. I would not be saying much, which would not need literacy, but only knowledge to handle that. With regard to basic template, World Bank is already doing that. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Charru. And I think one question was about...
Hello. Yeah. So I think someone asked about the students from IIPM. They asked about the behavioral aspect in the SPVs or throughout the smart cities. I assume it was for the SPVs. So actually, as rightly, sir also mentioned that, you know, most of the SPVs here are hybrid organizations, you know. They have people from the, they have, the leaders are mostly IAS and the SAS. Then down they have people from, you know, the private sector. There are a lot of people from US and Singapore have come in and joined in. And then they have consultants who work as a team along with them. So the behavioral aspects have to be really taken care of. And in fact, we recently hired some students from the IIMs to study this and, you know, bring about the training plan and all to, you know, improve on the behavioral aspects. One of the biggest issues that happens, you know, when a government organization, the government officers, those who have worked for the past 20, 25 years, and the people from the private sector, you know, those who are not used to be called sir and, you know, all those too much of respect, they are not used to too much of respect, while the government officers, the understanding is that, you know, they are the decision makers and hence they deserve that respect. So there's a big ego crash sometimes happens within the organizations, which is very true. I think most of the SPVs would face this. And here, I believe the role that the commissioners and the CEOs can play is to empower them rightly. The right person should be empowered in the right way. Again, I'm using the same word. So, when it comes to decision making, so decision making has to be left at to the technical team. It's a technical issue. There's a CFO sir is there from Pune. We have very specifically defined job roles. We have SOPs, system operating procedures, and we have job roles very specifically defined, and no one crosses their, you know, boundaries. They work within their limits, and this has worked wonders. So now we are working as a team, and after I go back, we have ice-breaking session as well for further gelling up within the teammates. So thank you. I hope I answered your question. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
In the context of what Gaurav, no? You said, ek aspect aur jo main bhool gaya kehna, is these consultants who have now come into cities, who have, dono taraf se problem ho rahi hai. They are facing it difficult to integrate into the municipal management systems, aur municipal management ki taraf se unko utilize nahi kar rahe hain. अगर आप उसको उनको यूटिलाइज नहीं करेंगे दे विल नेवर हैव द कॉन्फिडेंस टू बी एबल टू बी एबल टू ब्रिंग वैल्यू टू अ सिटी तो मेरी रिक्वेस्ट है कंसल्टेंट नीड टू बी ट्रेन्ड ऑल्सो बिकॉज आई एम वेरी 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 स्केप्टिकल इन सम सिटीज बाय द क्वालिटी ऑफ कंसल्टेंट्स दे नीड टू बी ट्रेन्ड दे नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड दे नीड टू रियली ये नहीं है कि आज उन्होंने एडवाइस दियो कल जाके अहमदाबाद बैठ गए फिर अहमदाबाद से एडवाइस दे के इंदौर चले गए और फिर लौट के आ गए लखनऊ भाई बैठ के जम के काम करने की जरूरत है गॉट टू रियली सिट डाउन एंड वर्क सो इट्स अ डबल एज्ड थिंग इन विच व्हाट वी आर सेइंग इज दैट द कंसल्टेंट्स आई मीन सिटीज सीम टू बी हैविंग 25 गुप्ता जी हाउ मेनी आर देयर इन अ सिटी 20 टू 25 कंसल्टेंट्स पर सिटी okay, maybe 10 to 12. 10 to 12 professionals in a city should be able to bring a lot of value. They can only bring value if the city knows how to utilize them. I think Pune has used them. Some of the more progressive cities know how to use professionals. I think there is a need for make. This is a very important point that government is putting professionals at your disposal and they're not being utilized fully. So kindly make sure they are used.
So I think on that note, and the, one of the questions, Michael, do you want to say something? No. I think what we'll do is because we are running out of time also, which I think every panel always is, we'll quickly jump into solutions because it would be a shame that especially the panelists here are working on multi-stakeholder initiatives that are working wonders in other places. Businesses have their own strategies. Government has their own. To just quickly recap on solutions and frameworks that have worked. And this was in response also to a question that was raised about the fact that there's a lot of keenness in individuals and organizations to work for the cities and a need from the cities to work with people who are really passionate. And how do we make that connection? Which brings us back to the earlier morning session in which Vikas had talked about the knowledge portal, and that's very important because we are hoping that this portal moving forward could kind of bridge this kind of gap as much as possible. Not only the need of consultants and solution providers, but also the solutions themselves available at one place, and then the cities can pick and choose of what has worked where and how it can be modified and used in the